liquid, solids, plasma, gas. Long ago, the four phases lived in harmony, but everything changed when... nothing's changed really. Incidentally, you can attribute each state of matter to each of the four elements, but in hindsight, that might be a bit misleading. Hi, I'm Thyme, and this is the third video to a four-part series on my version of breaking down the science behind Avatar: The Last Airbender. I say my version because I'm aware people have made similar content before, but they have some things I either disagree with or find to be not clear enough, with all due respect. I'll be skipping a few things that I've already explained beforehand, so to get the full experience, I suggest watching my previous videos on waterbending and airbending. Otherwise, sit back and relax, because I'll be getting into the most prominent and the most powerful, literally massive type of bending out of all of them.
Earth is the element of substance. The people of the Earth Kingdom are diverse and strong. They are persistent and enduring.
Earthbending, or what our world would call geokinesis, is the ability to control Earth. Like airbending, there aren't any notable natural phenomena that momentarily strengthen or weaken innate earthbending abilities in a bender. According to legend, the first people to learn this art were Oma and Shu, two star-crossed lovers from villages at war with each other. They studied, or were taught by, depending on who you ask, badger moles to be able to bend labyrinthine caves into the Kolau mountain range to meet in private. The cave is still there to this day, and the second largest city in the Earth Kingdom is named after them. Earthbending is exclusive to the Avatar and the people of the Earth Kingdom, which constitutes roughly 2/3 of the entire world's population. Okay, you know the drill. Ask yourself, what is it exactly that an earthbender bends? Think about it. For real this time, because this is not an easy question. Moving, compressing, and shooting chunks off the ground, controlling dust, mud, lava, spouting sand, creating quakes and earth waves, skating on earth waves, making shelters, walls, fissures, tunnels, columns, elevators, launch pads, as well as all manner of controllable apparel and accessory, telling when someone's lying, seismic sensing, moving entire tectonic plates. I can go on and on because out of all the bending arts, earthbending has the most diverse set of unique skills because there's a lot you can do with the earth. The problem is, as you guessed it, in semantics. Earth is a very arbitrary term. Do they bend minerals? Rocks? Soil? Metals? To answer that, we have to first go on a long tangent about solids and some inorganic chemistry, so put on your seatbelts. There are currently 118 elements officially recognized by modern science shown here in the periodic table, and they can be further classified based on their physical properties. To the right, we have nonmetals, elements that are dull, brittle, poor conductors, have low melting points, and are mostly gas at room temperature. To the left, we have metals, elements that are shiny, malleable, ductile, great conductors, have high melting points, and are all solid at room temperature with the exception of mercury. In the middle, we have metalloids, elements with a preponderance of properties in between metals and non-metals. There isn't a unanimously agreed standard for what a metalloid is, so the aluminum, for instance, is often considered metal, but can in very rare instances be recognized as a metalloid. Now, if you've noticed, most of the periodic table is composed of metals, but probably not the kind of metal you're used to hearing about. Table salt, for example, is actually a metallic compound because it involves the metal sodium. A lot of rocks and minerals that don't strike people as metallic, like quartz and feldspar, are composed partly, or more often than not, mostly of metals. In fact, the majority of solids you see in real life that are inorganic, including the entirety of the Earth's crust, are a combination of metal and non-metal elements, possibly metalloids too. What people normally refer to when they say metal is specifically metallic substances that are held together by what we call metallic bonds. There are many kinds of chemical bonds in chemistry, each with their own properties, although I won't be getting into them here. Table salt, despite containing metal, is held together by an ionic bond, so people don't normally refer to it as metal. Steel, on the other hand, despite sometimes being partly composed of non-metals, are mostly held together by metallic bonds, and so are more colloquially considered metal. Metallic bonds happen between metal elements because metals naturally have a very weak hold on their outermost electrons. So what happens when you put metal atoms together is the electrons end up dissociating from the parent atoms and start roaming around all together, forming a sea of electrons throughout the crystalline structure. This is why metals are so electrically conductive, because the electrons are free to move with little obstruction. This is also why metals are malleable and ductile. The sea of electrons, which are negatively charged, surround the positive ions that make up the structure, gluing them together with attractive forces. The bonds between positive ions themselves, though, are relatively weak, so with enough energy, you can rearrange the atoms and shape the crystal structure however you want, and the free electrons will still keep them intact. Furthermore, the structure doesn't have to be made of just one metal. It's common practice in the industry to mix and match different metals to obtain different properties, like increased strength or hardness for varying use cases. So instead of a crystal containing all iron, you may want to replace some of them with carbon to get steel. You get different kinds of steel based on the percentage of carbon content, as well as if you decide to add other elements like nickel or titanium. This homogeneous mix of elements involving at least one metal is what we call an alloy. The steel is an alloy of iron and carbon, much like brass is an alloy of zinc and copper, and bronze is copper and tin. Alloys almost never occur naturally, and so they're artificially manufactured. What occurs naturally instead are ores, which are rocks and sediments that contain valuable minerals, including metals. They're unusable as is because the metals are heterogeneously mixed together with other elements, forming oxides, sulfides, silicates, as well as other junk in a way that they're very non-uniform and poorly mixed together, unlike an alloy. That's why ores need to be processed first to extract the metal or mineral you want, and then you can mix them together in a controlled environment. Now that we've laid the groundwork, let's take a look at the most common occurrence of earthbending, which is just manipulating rocks and soil. Soil is divided to several layers called horizons, and a typical soil consists of approximately 45% minerals, 5% organic matter, 25% water, and 25% air, although these numbers may vary significantly based on the type of soil and in which layer. The upper layers of soil have more organic matter, dead or alive, and are generally more porous and humid. The lower layers contain more minerals and unbroken parent material, with the lowest layer, the R horizon, being almost exclusively unbroken parent material, also known as the bedrock. Seeing as water and air are constituents in soil, waterbenders and airbenders do hypothetically have a certain degree of control over Earth, although for one reason or another, they never display this, either because it's difficult to generate electromagnetic forces with the way air and water particles are situated inside the soil, or there's not enough space to do so. Or it's just not strong enough to fight the weight of the soil, probably a combination of all three, who knows. Either way, safe to say, an earthbender doesn't bend the air or the water, nor do they bend organic matter, otherwise they would be able to bend humans and other living organisms just as easily. They bend the minerals.
So, rock collecting? They're minerals.
Minerals are naturally occurring inorganic solids with a crystalline structure and definite range of chemical formula. All soil contains broken and unbroken rock. All rocks, be it in soil or not, are made of multiple minerals. And if the concentration of minerals in rock are high enough to be economically extracted, they are considered ores. Now, not all minerals are made of metallic compounds, and even fewer have naturally occurring metallic bonds. There are thousands upon thousands of minerals that have been found on Earth. Here are some of the most important ones. Feel free to pause. Some minerals have covalent bonds, some others have ionic bonds. Relatively few minerals, mainly native metals such as copper and silver, naturally come with metallic bonds, and these are considered true metals in the colloquial sense. Sometimes they even naturally form alloys. So the question becomes, do earthbenders bend all minerals indiscriminately? If not, which ones? Did you catch all that? Feel free to pause or jump back if you're still confused, otherwise let's move on. 2 years ago, Trick Theory in their video said earthbenders bend heavy metals in the earth. I disagree. Not all metals are heavy metals and not all minerals are metallic. And yet, Earthbenders very rarely seem to be limited by their choice of minerals from natural sources. We can conclude that they're able to manipulate all minerals universally, metallic or not, with a few exceptions we'll touch in a bit. Like waterbending though, it doesn't seem like they're able to manipulate the elements individually, only when they form minerals. Keep in mind that some minerals, like graphite, consist of only one element, and it's not even a metal. But chances are they can be bent nonetheless because they have a crystalline structure, therefore they classify as a mineral. Some other minerals, like platinum, are native metals, as in they naturally come with metallic bonds, so they can't be bent. So that's one exception. You know what else classify as a mineral? Ice. They meet all the requirements of a mineral, but earthbenders can't bend water because I've established in my previous video that the world of Avatar discourages overlapping. Earthbenders can't bend solid water despite being a mineral for the same reason airbenders can't bend gaseous water despite being gas, because it's within the domain of waterbending and so is another exception. That brings us to another point. Time. Minerals have to be solid. But we've seen them bend mercury and lava, so what's up with that? This is where we can extend their threshold of bending without overlapping with their other bending arts. Earthbenders can also bend mineraloids, mineral-like substances that don't demonstrate crystallinity and are sometimes partly organic. This includes, among other things, amber, obsidian, petroleum, and, you guessed it, mercury. Coal is another example. It's organic, but in imprisoned, they're perfectly bendable. Glass is also considered a mineraloid, and in the books, Avatar Kyoshi once bent glass out of her skin. In the case of lava bending, lava is just molten rock. The minerals are still there, they're just weakly held together because of the immensely high heat. This implies that earthbenders are able to bend minerals and mineraloids in liquid and solid forms. In fact, they might even be able to phase shift them with enough energy. Mercury is the only liquid metal at room temperature, but cesium, francium, and gallium have such low melting points you can melt them by using your body heat alone. In their liquid form, they're still perfectly bendable by earthbenders. Earthbenders would not have access to minerals in gas form because it's within the domain of airbending. Not that they need it, since benders will never realistically come across an environment where they would have gas metal to bend. The metal with the lowest boiling point is mercury, but that's still 357 degrees Celsius. And in that kind of heat, the earthbender would die sooner than they could even think about bending it. In the end, to answer this question, earthbenders bend all minerals and mineraloids in liquid and solid forms except ice and native metals. You're welcome to dispute or add to this in the comment section down below. Oh, and while you're at it, don't forget to leave a like, it really helps. Okay, we've established what earthbenders bend, now we go to the how. Earthbenders, like all other benders, use quantum physics, namely quasi-particles, to draw energy from worldly events and channel them to manipulate the Earth in their vicinity using electromagnetic forces. For a more extended explanation on how this works, visit my first video in the series. In the case of an earthbender, they harness the energy of plate tectonics, or the convection currents under the planet's crust. To move bits of the Earth around, all they have to do is create charge gradients in the way that it repels or attracts matter in whatever direction they choose, much like pointing a magnet. The way airbenders do it, which is through ionic thrust, only works inside fluids. The way waterbenders do it, which is through magnetizing outer layers of water using current loops, could work for Earth with a caveat. Earth is significantly heavier. On average, the Earth's crust at the surface is 3.4 times denser than water, so the same volume of Earth warrants way more energy to move around. On the bright side, it carries with it more inertia, so they pack a harder punch once you get them moving. Another, possibly easier alternative to earthbending, which a lot of people on the internet seem to agree with, is by charging the entire body of Earth as opposed to just the outer layers. Because benders can charge and discharge particles from afar using quasi-particles, they simply charge entire chunks through induction, either removing them off electrons or shoving electrons into them. Then they charge the medium outside this chunk to act like an external magnet, creating electromagnetic propulsion. This method would be difficult to do with water because not only is water less dense, but Earth is generally more conductive due to containing large numbers of ions. Pure water is non-conductive, so moving charges in water is generally harder to do. My argument against this is that magnetizing the air outside the Earth is more airbending than it is earthbending. And if that's allowed, then waterbending can work by bending the air outside the water instead of just the outer layers of water too. Either way, I don't have a definite conclusion to this, only possibilities, but if I had to choose, I like the ionizing the whole chunk explanation better. If we go by that explanation, lava bending works the same way. You ionize the molten minerals in the lava and move them as you would a normal rock. It'll just be more difficult because lava is incredibly hot by comparison, so it has more electrical resistance. Remember, the hotter the substance, the worse it conducts electricity. With enough energy, you may also control vibrations of the earth to melt rock into lava and vice versa. There are two ways they can go about this. The first way is to just violently oscillate the earth particles until it naturally melts from the latent heat. The second way, assuming earthbenders can magnetize air, is to create strong magnetic flux around the earth that induces current in it. Due to the earth's electrical resistance, it will heat up and eventually it will start to melt. This is called induction heating. The name is pretty self-explanatory. As for metal bending, we've established that earthbenders can't bend metal. That is to say, mostly synthetic substances held together with metallic bonds. What they bend are impurities in metal, which are substances that differ from the chemical composition of the material itself. The whole idea of metalwork is to create metallic substances with just the chemical composition you want, and everything else counts as an impurity. With carbon steel, for example, usually you want iron and up to 2% carbon. But throughout manufacturing and exposure to air, the iron might react with some oxygen, forming oxides, or sulfur, forming sulfides, as well as all kinds of other elements. Hell, maybe even bits of the ore it came from still remain unpurified. Maybe you'll find a bit of quartz in there, or some other rocky material that has non-metal bonds. There's no such thing as 100% pure metal. It's inevitable. Now, if these impurities somewhat resemble naturally occurring minerals, then earthbenders can treat them as such, and can bend them freely. They'd have less volume to work with, but just enough to electromagnetically manipulate the surrounding metal like unpurified earth. It'd be more difficult, sure. Not to mention metal is much more conductive than rock, so even though charging it is easier, keeping it charged is a bigger challenge, which is why metal bending is considered an advanced skill. But where there's a will, there is a way. Oh, before we move on, one last thing about metal bending. Being able to control electron flow in metals means earthbenders can't weld metals together, or the other way around, cut off electron flow in specific parts of the metal, removing metal bonds, therefore allowing them to have an easier time cutting through the metal. Once you know how they move rock through ionizing entire chunks of them, you can explain most of the skills earthbenders can do. Compressing is just pushing them from all sides. Launching is just pure magnetic propulsion. Hardening or shifting the ground is just a form of compression or decompression. Sand bending is just bending a bunch of tiny rocks, because that's really what sand and gravel are. Earthquakes and dust screens are just violently shaking the ground at different scales. Shaping and sculpting are really just tightly controlled combinations of pushing and pulling in different places. This also includes everything from writing on the ground to shifting entire tectonic plates. That leaves us with two things we haven't touched. Seismic sensing and bullshit sensing, something we all wish we have. Because the nature of earthbending is essentially moving electrically charged rocks around, a bender can create an electromagnetic field within their vicinity, mostly the ground they're standing on, to detect changes in movement of charged earth particles. This is the exact same principle behind hypersensitivity for airbending, only there, you're primarily creating the field in the air. There is a possibility that since earthbenders can somewhat bend air, they're able to do that too. And maybe that's how they sense airborne earth particles. Either that, or they create the field in their own body, which I think is less likely considering the body has very little earth mineral content. So, by ionizing the earth below their feet without moving anything voluntarily, earthbenders receive feedback from when another particle disturbs this field by bumping into any of the ionized particles. They can specify how and from where this disturbance comes, through whichever direction, as well as how much force is experienced by the displaced ions. This includes disturbances from the human heartbeat. Now, it's unlikely Toph reads someone's heart directly, so she probably reads the vibrations of someone's foot through the ground caused by their heart palpitation and blood pumping cycle. When you lie, you get anxious, your heart beats faster, and the vibration in your feet becomes stronger. If you can somehow lie without getting anxious, Toph can't read you. The vibrations would be incredibly subtle, but this is Toph we're talking about, so if anyone can do it, it's her.
I am the greatest earthbender in the world!
Except when the person is airborne, she probably can't read them in that case. Anyway, it's reasonable to believe that creating electric fields in the Earth also allow you to see where there are spaces, tunnels, and the such. Either the earthbender can sense the change in medium through refraction or reflection of ground vibrations, or they can just sense that there are parts of the ground they simply can't ionize. With that, we have now covered all the important earthbending skills, so let's sum it up concisely. Earthbenders are able to use quasi-particles to harness energy of tectonic movement or convection currents from the Earth's mantle and core. They are able to bend solid and liquid minerals and mineraloids except ice and native metals. They can't bend substances with primarily metallic bonds like alloys and manufactured metals. They can only bend trace minerals and other impurities inside the metal. By ionizing chunks of Earth, be it in solid or molten form, and magnetizing the surrounding medium, they can levitate, propel, shape, compress, and decompress Earth to different effects. By controlling vibrations or inducing current into Earth particles, they can shift their states between crystal and lava. By creating electric fields in the ground, they can sense changes in their environment, find underground structures, and read someone's heartbeat through their feet, which by extension lets them detect lies. Earth is the element of substance, exemplifying most of the planet and most of its people. It's strong, neutral, forbearing, and carries a lot of weight. It is just as much the beliefs by which earthbenders stand as it is the ground on which we all do. Congratulations on making it this far yet again. No calculations in my video because let's be honest, there'd be more information than necessary. If you want to know more about the math, visit Zia Steele's articles in the description. This video required a lot of research and I left out a bunch of things, so don't be shy to leave a comment if you have any questions or corrections. I'll reply as best as I can. The next video will be on firebending, so subscribe if you want to get notified on when it comes out. Thank you so much for watching. Leave a like if you like it, dislike it if you don't, and see you next time.